Lady Cranley's son has just come from Brazil. He's really ill, he might even kill. But everything at Cranley Hall is really nice. Hide him in an annex where nobody goes, just no one knows about her woes. Everything at Cranley Hall is really nice. When your eldest son's begun to turn a little tragic, you can hide him round the rear, he'll disappear like magic. You know you want to, there's no need to worry when you have a spare, a second heir with ginger hair. Everything at Cranley Hall is really nice.
Well, hi everybody. Welcome back to Doctor Who Literature. We're a member of the Direction Point Doctor Who Podcast Network. My name is Jason, and I'm your host on this journey, this very long journey. That opening number can mean only one thing. Jim Sangster, co-producer of this podcast, is back in the house with another original music composition. We are back in the 1920s, and we are back in the jazz age, one of your boys' favorite periods of history. This week, the book is Black Orchid, the February 1987 novelization by Terence Dudley of his own 1982 TV story. It is the final novelization of the Peter Davison era. Interestingly, the TV story that immediately preceded Black Orchid, The Visitation, was the first novelization of the Peter Davison era. Meanwhile, in real life, a new episode of Doctor Who premiered on Disney Plus on Friday night in the States, and then in the BBC on Saturday. We're talking about Boom, the third episode of the current season with Shruti Gatwa, written by Stephen Moffat. I will have my review of Boom at the very end of this episode. If you have not seen it yet, you can listen to the rest of the episode without fear of spoilers. My review will be largely spoiler-free. But again, if you have not seen the episode yet, you probably should watch Boom before you hear my review, which takes up about 4 or 5 minutes at the end of the episode. We've talked about Black Orchid. We talked about Jim Sangster's wonderful jazz composition to open the show. Speaking of composition, the composer for Black Orchid was Roger Lim, a mainstay of the Doctor Who music scene between seasons 18 and 22. His third Doctor Who score was for Black Orchid. Roger Lim's son, Jeremy, was seen on Doctor Who last week, playing the piano teacher in the cold open to The Devil's Chord. I didn't mention this last week because I was not aware at the time, and of course, June Hudson and Murray Gold were also seen in The Devil's Chord. This is an episode of Doctor Who Literature, which mirrors an episode of the Doctor Who Target Book Club podcast. That's the sister podcast to this show, which covers the Targets in story order. I was a guest, along with Tony and Dalton, on the Doctor Who Target Book Club podcast to talk about Black Orchid last year. I will put a link to that in the show notes. There's a lot of other good stuff in the show notes this week, so I do encourage you to check those out on Spotify or wherever else you get your Doctor Who literature. Except for YouTube, I'm not positive if the show notes propagate there, but I believe they do. I'm also going to be linking to James Couray Smith's most recent psychic paper entry. This is about Paradise Towers, and more specifically about the casting of Sylvester McCoy. Because Black Orchid came out in February 1987 as a novelization, right around the time that Sylvester McCoy would have been gearing up to perform his earliest work on Doctor Who for the 1987 season, season 24. Once again, James Couray Smith's psychic paper dovetails beautifully with what we are doing here on Doctor Who Literature. I will also have an interview with Stephen Moffat from the Nerdist website talking about the writing of Boom. I will allude to that as well at the end of the episode when I review that story. I will also be linking to my appearance on A Kettle and Some String talking about Tomb of the Cybermen. That is a topic that comes up during the conversation this week. My guest is the great Stephen B. from the New to Who podcast, a new Avengers podcast that he'll tell you about as well as his Reimagining Who website. Stephen is a great guest. This is his third time on Doctor Who Literature, and certainly not his last. We'll have a great conversation. We'll talk about Black Orchid. We'll talk about many other things, as well as baseball history, as longtime Doctor Who Lit listeners will know. That is a frequent topic of conversation on the show. And, of course, we are going to play my newest game. So there is a lot to talk about on this episode. Let's put an end to the preliminaries, and let's get to it.
Hi, I'm Rupert Booth.
I am known as Paul Ferry.
And my name is Barry Williams.
Together, we host Time Ram.
Time Ram's a cruel mistress.
It's a random number generator.
That also.
We roll a number from 1 to 13, and that's our doctor. Then 1 to 300 for the story, and then we ram them together.
Even if it doesn't make sense.
Cruel, I tell you.
Time Ram, putting the wrong doctors in the wrong stories, so you don't have to.
You're listening to Doctor Who Literature.
Alright, so everyone give a warm welcome back to Doctor Who Literature to Stephen B. Stephen from the New to Who podcast. Welcome back to the show, my friend. It's been a minute.
Oh, thank you. What a delight to be back. Yes, a thrill. And also for this particular story, which is a bit of a favorite of mine, not least in the Target audiobook form.
So this is your third time on the show. The first time we had you on was for Tomb of the Cybermen, book 41, mm-hmm. and then for Modern Undead, book 82. My mathematically inclined listeners will note there's a pattern there. That means the only thing to do is to have you back for book 123, which the way that we are counting here would be The Rescue. But you wanted to cover a book that comes up earlier than every 41st book. So we're here today to discuss Black Orchid. But as you know, it's a tradition on this show that we never get to the book of the week until several minutes into the conversation. So how are you, my friend? What have you been up to?
I'm doing okay, thank you. Still in Singapore, enjoying it very much. And yeah, life is sort of returning to an even keel after a sort of strange COVID period. And yeah, just enjoying life and everything that it brings my way.
I was going to tell you that this is special because we're recording this about 70 minutes after the latest episode mm-hmm. of the newest Doctor Who season drops in a worldwide streaming media release. So here in the States, it is 8:12 p.m., just turned 8:12, in fact, and episode 3 of the new series, Boom, written by Stephen Moffat, is now available for streaming, but I am choosing to have this conversation with you rather than watch the new episode.
You're a generous and good man. Thank you. Yes. Likewise, I haven't seen it yet, and I've only ever seen just the trailer for it. So I sort of go into spoiler mode, spoiler aversion mode, in the lead up to new episodes. So I have no idea what it is, other than it kind of looks like that scene out of Genesis of the Daleks where Tom's standing on a landmine, and it's written by Stephen Moffat. Can't wait.
Stephen Moffat has been with the revived show for almost 20 years now, because The Empty Child is 2005. Here we are in 2024. So he's gone from late middle age to early old age as a Doctor Who TV writer. And the question for me is he going to bring back the same bag of tricks that he used over and over again to arguably diminishing returns throughout his almost decade as showrunner? Or does he have new, fresh ideas for us?
It's a really good question, and look, I can't say one way or the other just yet because I haven't seen it, but I would say that with Moffat, there are definitely tropes. You go back to things like Press Gang, and the stuff that he's coming up with there is the stuff that he comes up with again in Doctor Who and, you know, coupling and stuff like that. So I'm assuming we're going to see some Moffat tropes, definitely, but I'd like to think that in the, well, it's been 5 or plus years since he left the show, that maybe he sort of replenished the well and we get to see something new as well, a bit of a twist on the old.
Like you, I am very spoiler averse. I want to go into these episodes knowing nothing about them. So My kid is out at her junior high school prom tonight, and by the time she gets home, she's not going to be in any mood to watch any television. But she did leave me instructions that I am not to watch this episode without her. So tomorrow morning, she has a softball game bright and early, and we're going to go to that. And once we're back from that, then we will watch the new Doctor Who episode together. I will say she is much more, speaking of old TV, into Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Mm-hmm.
So we started watching that one episode a night about 3 months ago, and we are now early in season 5, and she is much more excited about that. And these are episodes that aired now in the year 2000, so almost a quarter century. She's much more excited about that than she is about new Doctor Who. But starting with Wild Blue Yonder, she has watched every episode of the new RTD series with me, streaming on Disney Plus. And she, lovely. I don't think she would ever watch this show by herself, but she enjoys watching with me. She enjoys being on this show. So I'm going to honor that, and I'm going to watch the show with her tomorrow. And hopefully, when I do my Facebook read-through tonight, I will not receive too many spoilers about what this episode is.
Well, yeah, hopefully. Although it is a bit of a risk. I'm going to stay away from social media, I think, until I've seen it. Though I'll probably hop on after we finish, so I've got a bit of an advantage, I guess.
So what are you up to, either podcast-wise? I know you had a blog project going on, reimagining the classic series. Talk to me about your creative pursuits.
Well, I've recently started a podcast with Richard and Brendan from Flight Through Entirety fame, looking at random episodes of The Avengers. So we're covering effectively series 1 through 2, including actually the new Avengers as well. So that's been a lot of fun. And I'm getting to talk about another great love of mine. I think there's three sort of great classic pillars of that sort of sci-fi, spy-fi genre that comes out of the UK rather in the 60s. And, you know, The Avengers is one of them, The Prisoner is the other. Doctor Who, obviously, being my first great love. So that's great fun. But yeah, the Reimagining Who blog is continuing. I'm coming up to the 10th planet in a few days' time, which is the last story of the first Doctor, which will sort of culminate the, I think it's about 15 episode run of that first Doctor block that I've reimagined. And again, just great fun, putting it out there, not really sure who's reading or who isn't, but just enjoying the process of thinking through how you would reimagine classic Who for a modern audience with a massive budget, but also, I guess, using the syntax and the language of television, which is so very different to 1960s television.
It's interesting you mentioned The Avengers. That is a show with which I am just not especially familiar. I know of its very large cultural footprint. So I know about Patrick McNee, and I know about Honor Blackman. Patrick McNee, I guess, how some people call him. People who want to pronounce his name correctly. Honor Blackman, Diana Rigg. So I know the broad outlines of the show. I know that much of the first season or two doesn't exist. Mm-hmm. And I believe it was a co-production in the U.S., and it would have been aired domestically here in the 1960s, which obviously is before my time. There's only one episode of The Avengers that I have watched all the way through.
Okay.
And that's because last year I was a guest on Dave Rennie's A Kettle and Some String podcast.
Mm-hmm.
And the episode that I was assigned was Tomb of the Cybermen. And I know that much more so than myself, Dave Rennie is a podcaster who does his homework. He brings receipts, and his episodes are 2 hours long. So you don't mess around going on his show. You don't wing it on his show. I wing it on this show all the time. He does not. So I went to the discontinuity guide, which I have on my Kindle, and I looked at the roots section for Tomb of the Cybermen, as derived by Keith Topping and Martin Day and Paul Cornell. And I watched both Hammer Horror Mummy films that they said were a direct influence on Tomb of the Cybermen, because George Pastel, who played Gleeg, was in both of those movies, playing essentially the same type of character. And they also mentioned an Avengers episode, The House That Jack Built. So thanks to co-producer of this show, Jim Sangster, I watched The House That Jack Built, and I saw some very obvious influences on Tomb of the Cybermen. That is a show that I would love to watch all the way through to the extent possible. But my own time at home right now is kind of booked, because I have one episode of Buffy the Vampire Slayer with my kid, and then I have 2 half-hour episodes of Dark Shadows for myself every night. I just reached the halfway point of that series the other day.
Gosh.
I just reached episode 623 out of 1,245 numbered episodes. So I don't have time for anything else right now, but when I finish Dark Shadows or Buffy, maybe I will go back and start an Avengers pilgrimage and do your podcast alongside.
Oh, I love that. It's called the three-handed game. It is a random approach, so it's not the flight through entirety of the Avengers. But yeah, that would be great. And I always feel like there should always be something to look forward to. So saving stuff up like that is a nice thing to do, something to look forward to, rather than sort of find, hang on, I've sort of watched everything and listened to everything and read everything that I wanted to. So yeah, great.
You know, now that I am on the wrong side of 50 and I am closer to retirement than I am to the start of my working career, and now that my kid is much closer to adulthood than she ever was to being a child, I'm trying to reorganize my life so that I am living the best life possible. I want to travel more. I don't work Fridays over the summer. I am very fortunate to have a career that allows me to do that. So I do a lot of urban exploration, and every Friday in the summer, July, August, September, I try to do something in New York City that I've never done before, and I have yet to run out of things to do.
That's wonderful.
But
wow.
I also want to do a lot more domestic travel. There's a lot of things in this country that I want to see that I have not seen. I've never seen the Alamo. I have not seen the Field of Dreams Stadium in Iowa, which was the site of the Kevin Costner movie. There's 9 states out of the 50 that I have never been to. So there's a lot more that I want to do. And I'm actually going to be in London twice this coming summer. So there's just a lot of things that I want to take care of. And watching more great TV is one of my goals. So the Avengers is going to be on the short list of things that I need to see while I am still around and able to process information.
I'm sure you certainly will. But how wonderful the idea of being able to sort of have the 3-day weekends in the summer to wander around New York. That's a genius idea. You're very lucky. I'd love to do that.
The way the American economy is going on year 43 of Reaganomics is this is not the norm. Most folks have been kicked out of full-time jobs with benefits, and they are now in the gig economy. I am very fortunate that I have a position and I have a little bit of freedom and security to do that. So talk to me about the three-handed game. What was the genesis of this? What is the format of the show? And how far into it are you?
Oh, like we've just recorded, or we'll be recording tomorrow, I think, our 4th or 5th episode. So it's really early on. The genesis of this is kind of like with all things, a random conversation that sort of leads on to, hey, maybe we could do this. But Brendan and Richard and I have been talking about the Avengers for years and years, and I guess it was inevitable that one day we would sit down in front of microphones and record it. Those two from Sydney and myself remotely from Singapore, we'll pick an episode at random, pretty much at random, and just go through a commentary, I guess, a watch-along, and come up with all sorts of silly jokes, but also reasons for why we love the show, I guess.
How do you select the episode randomly? Is it by a random number generator or one of the random episode guide generator websites or some other nefarious method involving the rolling of bones and the casting of blood?
No. We're not that organized. Random in the sense that we'll sort of think about, well, which ones could we do next? And that's kind of as random as it gets.
I don't know, Richard. I did record an episode of Trap One with Brendan. He was very kind to let me use his voice on an episode of this show last year. If you recall, I was doing the feature on your favorite Doctor Who episode of the first 60 years. So he did a bit for Doctor Who literature on that. I want to get to know him better, certainly, but I think listening to this show will be a good way for me of doing that.
Splendid fellows, both of them.
So that's the Avengers. And of course you have your classic Doctor Who blog, your own reinvention project going on there. What has been your take on the new series so far? We are now 3 episodes down and a 4th episode out that we have yet to see of Shuri Gatwa and Millie Gibson, plus the 3 RTD David Tennant reprise episodes from last year. So that's 7 new Who episodes in the last 6 months. How are you feeling about these?
Generally positive. I think it's still too early to sort of come to any kind of conclusion about Shuri and Millie and the first series of the 15th Doctor. It is the 15th Doctor, isn't it?
We are. That's the official count. Doctor. David Tennant gets to be both 10 and 14 at the same time.
Yeah. I think we'll probably sort of have a better feel once we get to the end of the series and figure out where all this is going. One thing I have noticed, and I've mentioned this to a good friend of mine who's got that wonderful blog, Random Hooters, known as Castellan's Spandrel, Johnny Spandrel. And I've noticed that there's no B-plot in the shooty episodes. It just kind of seems to be entirely focused on the two leads. And I wonder whether that is a conscious choice or whether that's, something that's meant to sort of foreground the two main characters. But there doesn't seem to be a B-plot in the sense that, like, what else is going on at the same time and how those two plot strands perhaps can sort of come together at the end. So that's interesting. I want to see how that plays out, and maybe that's a discussion for another podcast at another time. But that's probably maybe something that I've noticed that kind of feels a bit strange in Doctor Who. Like, I always feel like a good Doctor Who script has two pieces coming together from opposite ends to meet into the middle, and I'm not sure that's happening so far.
This is, and again, I'm marking myself off as a special kind of fan here. I think Doctor Who is at its best when it's being run by radical young people in their 20s. Mm. Verity Lambert, under the age of 30, minority. Waris Hussein,
yeah,
under the age of 30, minority. The best directors in the 1960s, Michael Ferguson, Michael Imeson, these are all very young people, either unaware that there are rules or doing their best to break the rules and move TV kicking and screaming into a new age. Yes. 1960s Doctor Who is not stuffy sitting room television. This is living, breathing, grab you by the throat material within the context of the technical limitations of the era and the budget. There is nothing boring about 1960s Doctor Who when young people are in charge. And that's why I want to do my Hartnell week by week podcast whenever Doctor Who literature comes to an end. Here's the thing, though. Doctor Who right now is being made by 60-year-old white men, RTD and Stephen Moffat. And I was hoping that they would go back to basics for the new series after Chris Chibnall handed over the reins, speaking of 60-year-old white men, and find some young woman in her late 20s who grew up on the Christopher Eccleston series and wants to bring Doctor Who into its next iteration. So I thought going back into the past was a mistake. That's one point. My second point is that I am no longer Doctor Who's target demographic. Doctor Who's,
same.
At least the Space Babies, is pitched at 8-year-olds with just enough politics in there for their parents in their 30s and early 40s to enjoy. This show is not for me anymore. And that's a bit of a sobering realization. I'm never going to stop watching. But Doctor Who should not be broadcast at me. It should not be made solely for 50-year-old heterosexual white lawyers. I don't want Doctor Who to be about me anymore. That being said, Space Babies was not to my real taste. I'm not going to say that it's my least favorite episode of Doctor Who ever, but I will say I never want to watch it again because bodily function humor is not my thing. I definitely enjoyed Devil's Cord. I did record a Trap 1 on that, which is dropping soon, and I have some nitpicks about Devil's Cord. You know, that's the one thing about being a lawyer. You can nitpick anything, even stuff you love. I want to be impressed by Doctor Who again, but what I love about having already established that the classic series was radical and innovative and not a boring sitting room show, what was great about the classic series is you had these layered plots that had room to breathe. You had a subplot for each companion. You had secondary and tertiary characters who would anchor entire scenes by themselves without the Doctor or companions involved.
Mm.
I call those Lime Grove D scenes, where you have tertiary characters talking to one another for 3 or 4 minutes at a time while the regular cast is doing a costume change. There's nothing like that in the new series. So the guest characters are not as memorable. And as you say, there's no B-plot. Buffy the Vampire Slayer, there's A and B plots. Sometimes there's C plots. If you watch Planet of Fire, there's 3 different plot strands going on all at once. Now, people like to criticize the John Pertwee era for each serial being quote-unquote 2 episodes too long, which is my least favorite bit of Doctor Who criticism ever. But those were stories that started in one place and ended in another with multiple supporting characters. That's the kind of TV that I prefer. Radical for its day, boring and archival now. Which brings us, I guess, to Black Orchid, because Black Orchid is the first of a new breed. It is two episodes of Doctor Who rather than four. It is the first two-episode Doctor Who serial since Edge of Destruction. This is Doctor Who without the padding, and most fans criticize it for being not complicated enough, so go figure. You can't satisfy anybody. What is it about Black Orchid that caused you to volunteer to be my talking head for the week?
It was actually the Target version of the series, which I was never close to. I only ever saw the story once, and it was only part two. I'd missed the this was in the days, by the way, in the early 90s on the ABC, where it was repeated at 4:30 a.m. And every now and then, the VCR timer would fail. And you can imagine my disappointment at not being able to see the first episode of Black Orchid, a story I'd never seen before. Couldn't find the Target anywhere. And it wasn't until perhaps much later when the DVD came out that I was able to see it. So I never really had a close connection to the televisual version of this story. But the novelization is something that really has stuck with me. And I think it is one of those sort of underrated Target novelizations, not in the sense that it's a classic in the same way that perhaps Doomsday Weapon is, or you know, one of the great Mac Hulk ones. That's not the case. But what it does is so different and so interesting and so elusive, and it's particularly beautifully brought to life in the Target audiobook read by Michael Cochrane, with that wonderful sound design, and I'll talk about some of those elements later on, I guess, that it really is a go-to for me now in a way that, and this is perhaps a little bit sheepish of me to admit, like when I need to have a moment to sort of calm down, or an afternoon where I'll go on a long hike just to sort of clear my head, this will be the background noise to that. I find it incredibly soothing, but also just rather clever and beautifully written in a way that is both, as I say, elusive, but also very sort of, it's not the work of a great writer, but I can see how a writer is trying to stitch together elements of other great pieces of literature or other great writers into a Doctor Who story. And that kind of bricolage approach to Doctor Who is something that I particularly appreciate, and particularly appreciate in a sort of 1920s murder mystery set at a country manor kind of way as well. So yeah, that's why I immediately shut my hand up. I think when we were talking almost as early as, was it Tomb of the Cybermen? I thought, I think I put my hand up for this one. It's a great favorite of mine.
So, of course, we can't talk about a book without talking about the cover first. So yes. Here we have, and I'm showing this on video for you to look at because we're doing this face-to-face.
Thank you.
For my audience, this is audio only, but if you're watching on YouTube, this is the cover detail that you will see. It is a Piero clown, possibly Peter Davison, possibly George, the villain of the story, so to speak, juggling an indecent amount of cricket balls. Is this, again, Jim Sangster has me asking everybody, although I haven't done proper Target novelizations in a while because of all the bonus books, what is your favorite Target cover of all time, and why is it not this one? Because this cover is definitely one of the ones you think of when you think about wacky out there Target covers.
Yeah, it is, and maybe that's also why I kind of like it. It adds again to that tapestry of Doctor Who. There's that beautiful, I think maybe my favorite version of the TARDIS, and here's the nerd alert, the stacked roof TARDIS, in that beautiful blue, that sort of in the just over the shoulder of the Piero. I think it's Peter Davison because it's the nine cricket balls, and you know, obviously has a wonderful spell in the book about being a bit of a cricketing demon. And, you know, the Jacobean pile behind him as well. So there's a kind of elegance about it, but it really does suffer from the fact that Peter Davison's face is not allowed to be on the books because we're now in the era of, hang on, are we still in the era of Colin, or has this gone into the era of Sylvester at this point? I'm not sure.
This book is February 1987. So in real life, Colin Baker has already been fired and Sylvester McCoy either was cast or was in the process of, probably had already been cast because they would have filmed in the spring. So they're probably about to break ground on Time and the Ronnie. Now,
yeah,
when the book is written,
right,
though, when the book is written, it's probably mid-1986, so Trial of a Time Lord has not yet aired. So I don't know how closely Terence Dudley, speaking of white men in their 60s, that was him, I don't know if any of that psychochronography was in his mind, but as this book hits the shelves, Sylvester McCoy is the Doctor and is already at work or is about to start work on Time and the Ronnie. So in terms of publication order, we are at the final new series, the final classic series Doctor, I should say, already.
Crazy to think, isn't it? But yeah, you know, J&T's edict that, you know, anyone who isn't the current Doctor shouldn't be on the cover of Targets, I think sort of harms that. It probably would have been better with Davison's face on there. But no, I don't think it's a terrible cover. I think it's just one of those covers that's like, that is so unlike any other Doctor Who Target novelization cover. But at the same time, Black Orchid is one of those stories that's very unlike any other Doctor Who story as well. So perhaps it's fitting.
I don't believe there was a Blue Spine cover of this, because the Blue Spines were a chance to get the Doctors back on the cover, because obviously under J&T you weren't allowed to have past Doctors on a new book, and there were so many past Doctor books coming out under his tenure. So there's a large run of classic series novelizations without the Doctor's face on them. Plus, of course, you weren't having Peter Davison or Colin Baker on the cover of their own books. The Blue Spines, I should say, remedied that. But I don't collect the Blue Spines. That's a bridge too far for me. And just doing a quick online search now, I don't think there was ever a Blue Spine edition of Black Orchid, because they didn't do them all. So this is probably one of the few books where there is no cover with the Doctor's face on it.
Yeah, and I don't think too many people would be upset with that. Like, there's not many people clamoring for a copy of Black Orchid in the Blue Spine version. I don't think that's the case. So, I mean, I'd love for there to have been an entire run of the Blue Spines. I guess at that point I would have to insist on buying them, because I've obviously got the full version of the original run. And if there was a full version of the Blue Spine, I would definitely buy it. So something for the BBC to consider. But no, this was never re-released, and it's actually a really difficult target to find in Australia. I mean, it was not until, as I say, a lot later that I was able to get my hands on it, and I'm more familiar with it, in fact, as an audiobook, and I think that was released the best part of 10 years ago, perhaps a little bit more now, and that's my version of Black Orchid, as I say.
It's not especially rare as eBay prices go. My very first eBay search for this turns up a copy that is available for only $9, which in this day and age is a pretty good deal for Target books. Books like Edge of Destruction or Wheel in Space, which are perceived to have scarcity issues, go for a lot more.
This is true.
I would have collected this as it came out. In 1987, the bloom was starting to come off the rose for my first wave of Doctor Who fandom. 1987 was the year that I got back into baseball fandom and the year that I discovered girls. And as this podcast goes on through the 1987 books, I will be illustrating how much less of a place Doctor Who was having in my life. I didn't envision that 37 years later I was going to be talking about it every single week for 90 minutes at a time, mind you. So I bought this book. I read it once. It didn't make a particularly big impression on me, but that segues us neatly into my next question. There are three two-part Peter Davison episodes. Two of them are written by Terence Dudley, and one is plotted by Eric Pringle, and in the event was written uncredited by Eric Sayward. Each of the three is a novelization, two written by Dudley, one written by Eric Pringle, presumably from Eric Sayward's scripts. Each of the three two-part novelizations have twice the real estate, because the Target book is usually a default four-part story, 130, 140 pages. These books get the same page count, but half the plot. So each of the three books has a different way of filling up the space. The Awakening, which we've already covered on the show, does not add a single new scene. It just tells the existing TV story with a lot more descriptive prose. The King's Demons, which we've already covered on this show, rewrites the second half of the story and invents whole new subplots and changes the fate of one of the secondary characters, and is essentially a very different animal from the TV story. Black Orchid kind of finds a middle ground, because it's the last of the three to come out, which of course leads to the delicious continuity error where the Doctor recalls the events of King's Demons in this book, even though in story order it ain't happened yet. So talk to us, how does this book use the extra space, and does it use the extra space well?
Look, I'm biased, so my answer's not going to sort of conform to the majority, who will say that it is largely overwritten, that there is too much florid prose in it, overly descriptive, with meandering sort of passages that don't really go anywhere. And I can't really sort of argue against that other than on the grounds of taste. But I think the other thing that it does really quite well is to sort of give interiority to the characters in a way that I don't think we see too many times elsewhere in a target or even on screen as well. I think there's, in addition to, you know, the pages dedicated to the cricket section, which I love, by the way, because I grew up playing and watching cricket as a young kid in Australia. So it's kind of the familiarity of that, I guess, and putting the Doctor into one of your favourite games growing up was a wonderful thing to sort of read, I guess. But no, I think what you get is, as I say, that interiority. And Dudley uses a kind of shifting third-person narrative perspective or point of view. And he'll sometimes dip in and out of these characters while sort of maintaining, I guess, a third-person point of view for most of the time. And I think that's really instructive and really sort of illustrative, and perhaps even, in a way, sort of points to a version of Doctor Who that we didn't get. And I think it's probably a better version. There's so much, not just familiarity, but I guess, you know, genuine connection and even love, I guess, between the TARDIS regulars, which certainly isn't there through season 19. I think that's kind of incidental at best, and maybe it's just an artifact of the fact that 1981 televisual syntax doesn't have that in its vocabulary. But, you know, we kind of get the impression, not that there's any evidence for it elsewhere, that, you know, this is a team that has travelled together for a long time, they know each other intimately, that there's a great fondness for one another. And that's sort of illustrated, particularly through Tegan, I think. You know, there's moments where I've written it down. I've got so many pages of notes. I shouldn't have done this now. I'm not going to go searching through them. But effectively, she's talking about, you know, how charming the Doctor can be when he wants to be. And there's obviously a great affection on Tegan's behalf for the Fifth Doctor that sometimes isn't really there, I don't think. You know, I feel like that's sort of the isolated examples that we see on screen. But here it's quite evident. And, you know, Tegan's sort of place in 1920s, you know, upper class societies is sort of examined as well, particularly in her role as an air hostess. And there's a great passage, I think it's two or three sentences only, where, you know, there's a servant maid, Joyce, I think her name was, who's assigned to sort of, like, you know, wait hand and foot on Tegan and Nyssa. And she sort of catches herself thinking, oh, you know, what a time this was, where servants were expected to hang around and, you know, wait on their social betters. And then she realizes, well, hang on a second, this is what I do as part of my job, as part of an air hostess. You know, what has changed in the intervening 60 years? And that kind of insight, I guess, into the interiority of the characters is something that is I guess, the opportunity through, you know, adapting a two-parter into, well, it's more than 128 pages, isn't it? It's far longer than your average target standard length of novel. And I think, well, I appreciate that. I like that because I know that this isn't Earth Shock. This isn't scene after scene after action scene. This is an opportunity for extended character pieces and interior monologues and divergence onto village greens for cricket matches and, you know, through corridors and priest holes of Jacobean piles and mansions. I think that's part of the charm for it for me. So I'm in the minority, I realize this, but the sort of sedate, pleasant, character-led writing, which does veer obviously into sort of that very florid prose, is something that appeals to me. I can't help it.
That's a great point, the word interiority. This book does give its characters room to breathe, and I don't know if somebody sat Terence Dudley down after reading the manuscript of King's Demons and said to him, you're a sexist, misogynist dinosaur, and your description of Tegan is embarrassing. Tegan becomes arguably the principal POV character in this book. And again, I'm American, so I know baseball inside down, upside out, backwards, to mangle some words together. There is a cricket playing community in Brooklyn, and when I am in Prospect Park, I do see people playing cricket. I don't really know the rules. I know that in its broad outlines, it has some similarity to what baseball is now. I learned more about cricket from reading this book than from anything else, because Terence Dudley does go deep into the rules and some of the lore, using Tegan as his guide. Mm. And then Tegan, when she is talking to Sir Robert, when she's charming and he's a little bit flirtatious, Tegan comes across much better in this book, I feel, than in King's Demons. And that's another point in favor of Black Orchid for me, because this is the TARDIS crew at rest, at least in episode one. This is the TARDIS crew having fun, at least in part one. And more importantly, we get them out of those same JNT edict costumes. So Nyssa is in a fancy costume. Tegan is in a fancy costume. Adric is out of his baggy pajamas. Blue and green and yellow pajamas. And the Doctor is first in a elegant silk bathrobe, and then he is in his Pierrot clown costume to match George Cranley. This is a fun look at the TARDIS crew. I think part one is better than part two. I don't like the idea. And this happens in way too many Doctor Who stories, where a secondary character is killed off the second their plot utility runs out. In an ideal version of the story, George Cranley doesn't die at the end. But because they're going for the Agatha Christie vibe, I can see why he dies. But I also love the Jazz Age. I am a big fan of Annette Hanshaw, who chronologically is a couple of years after Black Orchid would have taken place. But I like those Jazz Age records, and I like the style of music. And there's a lot of that in the background in Black Orchid, especially in part one. For me, these are all things that people decry about the story, but for me, they're all major selling points.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I want to touch on, did you say Annette Hanshaw?
Annette Hanshaw, yes.
Is that in any way related to the song that the Doctor sings around I want to be happy, but I cannot be happy until I make you happy? Which I think is, I know it from the Ella Fitzgerald version from about perhaps a dozen years later after this is set, but it's from a musical. Is this where the reference to last week, Annette Hanshaw, comes from? I'd love to know more about this. You mentioned it last week and I was intrigued.
So I believe the musical that we're referring to is No, No, Nanette.
Yeah.
Now, No, No, Nanette is also legendary in baseball history.
Oh.
Arguably the most famous player in the history of baseball and the greatest player in the history of baseball is a fella named Babe Ruth. And that's probably a name that is known outside of American borders.
Yeah.
He grew up in Baltimore. He grew up in an orphanage, not because he had no parents, but because he was incorrigible. And his father, who owned a tavern, German immigrant, couldn't handle him. So he grew up in an orphanage, learned to play baseball, was signed by a local minor league team, and then made his major league debut with the Boston Red Sox, 1914 or 1915. By 1919, Babe Ruth is already the best player in baseball. The New York Yankees purchase Babe Ruth from the Red Sox because the Red Sox owner was a Broadway producer, and as the legend would have it, he needed the money to produce No, No, Nanette. So he sold Babe Ruth to the Yankees for about $20,000. In 1920, Babe Ruth sets an all-time record for most home runs in a season by any player in history, breaks his own record several times more over the next decade, takes the Yankees to the World Series in 1921, 1922, 1923, 1926, 1927, 1928, 1932. The Red Sox go from being baseball's premier franchise in the first 20 years of the 20th century to being a laughingstock. They won the World Series with Babe Ruth in 1918. They didn't play in it again until 1946. They didn't win it again until 2004
because of
what was called the Curse of the Bambino, which was one of Babe Ruth's nicknames.
Mm-hmm.
Bambino being Italian for Babe. Selling Babe Ruth to the Yankees, who became the most lucrative baseball franchise in history, so that the owner of the Red Sox could fund No, No, Nanette. If you go to the Wikipedia page for No, No, Nanette, which I am on now, there is a full paragraph on the Curse of the Bambino. Now, it turns out that it was not No, No, Nanette that was financed by the sale of Babe Ruth. It was the non-musical version of the play which later became No No Nanette, which was funded by the sale of Babe Ruth. But this is a fact. These are all things that happened. So the song you're talking about is I Want to Be Happy, correct?
That's the one, yes.
Now, that has appeared in several movies. There's a Benny Goodman version, there's a Doris Day version, there's an Ella Fitzgerald version. I don't believe that Annette Hanshaw covered this song. At least if she did, I'm not familiar with it, although I can name 20 of her other songs. And it's not listed on the Wikipedia. But I am a big fan of Annette Hanshaw, and because her music is still technically under copyright, I can't really use it on the show. But there is a Bollywood film called Sita Sings the Blues, which is all set to Annette Hanshaw music.
Oh, okay, wow, that sounds great. But where does the reference at the end of last week's episode to Annette Hanshaw come in terms of the novelization or the story Black Orchid? I'd love to sort of square this circle.
You're asking me to remember something that I said last week, and my memory no longer extends that far back, so I don't recall exactly what I said.
Well, we're in the that sort of golden jazz age, aren't we? So I guess it's all of a piece.
Yeah, I mean, when I think the jazz age, she is, for me, the first singer that comes to mind. There are many others. But her musical heyday would have been 1928, 1929. The movie Applause, which came out around that time, features her heavily on the soundtrack.
So it's very much of this time.
As Black Orchid is fictionally taking place, she would not have been discovered yet.
Okay, all right, got it. All right. I love, though, that this is where Doctor Who can take us through Babe Ruth and baseball back to musicals and jazz singers of the 1920s. It's all a piece, as I say. That's that's great.
And then, of course, when the TV movie came out, we are just past the anniversary, May 14th, of the TV movie airing in America, the 1996 TV movie. Mm-hmm. There was an Ella Fitzgerald-type song to which the Seventh Doctor is listening on the gramophone in the TARDIS console room at the beginning.
Yeah.
And then to square the circle, to use a phrase that you just used, Paul McCann listens to it at the very end. That, I believe, was an original composition written for the TV movie in the style of Ella Fitzgerald, but was not actually an Ella Fitzgerald number.
Yeah, it's true. I honestly thought it was an Ella Fitzgerald track because it just sounds so much like her. But yeah, they were a bit cheap on the copyright, so they recorded their own. I love that story.
If you are ever in New York, and I hope that you manage to make it here while we're still acquainted.
I'd love that.
I work in the West Village. Not too far from where I work is a historical plaque for what used to be the jazz club where Ella Fitzgerald first performed the song Strange Fruit, which is kind of an anthem of the civil rights movement here in the States. So I work near a very famous Ella Fitzgerald historical marker.
I'll definitely have to go to that and preferably be with you when I'm next in New York. That sounds amazing. Yes, please.
I am not an expert on the jazz age. There are people who know a lot more than me. I just have a particular interest in Annette Hanshaw, so her discography I know very well, the others not so much. So don't consider me an expert on the jazz age, but I enjoy that style of music. The Andrews Sisters came a little bit later, but I was raised on their music. They were the first American recording act to do a song in Yiddish, so that was my entry to them. So this is a style of music that I enjoy, even though it's 100 years old, and that's one of the selling points of Black Orchid for me.
Yeah, no, I agree, absolutely. And again, to go back to the audiobook, it's very much present. It's very much a conscious decision there around the production to ensure that there, it sort of evokes that era through that music. Obviously, there's the sort of Charleston-esque, if it isn't quite the Charleston music, sort of on in the background, and, you know, the Doctor singing via Michael Cochran's sort of a cappella, the version of the song. But even just, for instance, as the 5-hour epic sort of begins of this Target novelization, there's almost like a Poirot-esque sort of refrain that continues to sort of be used throughout as well. And when I say Poirot, I sort of mean that sort of BBC David Suchet kind of series.
Well, that's our second Agatha Christie reference of the hour, because this is a book that owes a lot to Agatha Christie, among other British mystery writers of the era.
Oh, absolutely. And this is, I guess, this is where I was sort of going with this point. The music sort of puts us back into that period. Agatha Christie is absolutely there. It's murder mystery to some extent, although not quite. But it sort of evokes that sort of country manor house murder mystery that Agatha Christie is so famous for. But the other thing that I think it does is to evoke that P.G. Wodehouse comedy of manners, which is, again, contemporaneous of this period as well. And, you know, the sort of, when I say comedy of manners, one of the things that Dudley does particularly well and foregrounds in the novelization is the strict social rules that govern the etiquette of discussion even, and what's allowed and what's not allowed in terms of questions and lines of conversation. You know, the doctor's allowed to sort of maintain his anonymity because it's impolite to ask too much about your guests. And that's just, you know, it's so absurd almost in terms of a pretext to the drama, but it is actually really quite interesting in terms of it being, true to the time perhaps, and also true to the social class that we sort of found ourselves in, that English gentry, landed gentry.
And I believe it's in the book where one of the characters realizes the doctor cannot be a murderer because he's too good at cricket.
This is wonderful. And then again, the centrality of cricket, this is why it's so important to the novelization and to the story, and why we get, you know, it's perhaps the best part of 10 minutes on the screen, but also the best part of about 45 minutes in the audiobook adaptation. The reason why is because cricket is synonymous with the with effectively what Orson Welles once called, you know, the word that best sums up the English gentleman is decent and decency. Let me see if I can find the quote. But there's this idea effectively that comes from like the preamble to cricket of its constitution, of its rules and regulations. And it's something along the lines of that the game is to be played not only within the laws, but the spirit of its laws as well, which I think is a sort of a marvelous sort of encapsulation of what cricket as a metaphor, as a social metaphor, is as well. And you're right, you know, the way that the doctor is, you know, portrayed as this absolute, you know, cricketing demon, I guess, both with bat and the ball, is to sort of establish his credentials as a gentleman initially, and then how that is subverted, I guess, by the allegations or the, you know, him being framed as a murderer, and what that then does to tip upside down that entire worldview that the English gentry have of, you know, decency and whatever else, which is actually very much a veneer.
So that's one thing that I love about Doctor Who. I think it was Keith who asked me this last week on the Slipback episode, why am I, an American, a fan of this show? One of the things that I love about it, and if you listen to my appearance on Reality Bomb last winter during their Essentials episode, what I love about Doctor Who is the fact that it's never the same show twice, and it can go anywhere, back and forth, past, present, future, from week to week. So the fact that before this, you have a story set in the 17th century, before that, you had an Ursula Le Guin fable set in outer space with a gigantic papier-mâché snake. Immediately after this, you have a two-fisted outer space epic with killer robots and killer androids and human traitors and Beryl Reed playing one of the most misunderstood guest spots in Doctor history. Right. Agreed. In the middle of that is this delightful, witty, civilized two-parter about people sitting around an expensive mansion, sipping tea, talking about cricket, and using the word jolly every 45 seconds of screen time. You and I both know there is a dark veneer to this upper crust nobility. We know this was not an ideal world. We know this is not anything to emulate. But it's fun for Doctor Who to hobnob in that society just for 2 weeks and enjoy it. And one of the things that I like about the novelization is that the character of Latoni is not treated very well on screen. He is treated as a servant. In the book, it is made clear that he is being received and honored as a chief of a tribe, and he is given full rights around the house, and he's not a servant. And in fact, the great thing about the book is the same way that Terence Dudley saves Geoffrey DeLacy in the King's Demons novelization, he saves Latoni in this book. So Latoni is not a servant and he doesn't die. Two things that are a bit sour about the TV This is Terence Dudley going away from how the actual historic Latoni would have been treated and treating him in a much more 1980s befitting manner.
I think that's probably true, actually, yeah. But there's still, nonetheless, that sort of element. And again, the book is so rich in tropes, and here with Latoni, Dita Latoni, it's the noble savage trope, I guess. But you're right. For all of that, there's a greater humanity and humaneness with which the character's treated because, you know, he's seen as a visiting dignitary almost, you know, someone who is hosted by the English aristocracy. You know, here he is, someone who's, you know, a chief tribesman of the, I don't even know if it's a real life tribe that Dudley has made up actually, but, you know, an Indian tribe from the Orinoco. And I think that's much kinder, I guess, and less needlessly awful than what we get in the television series.
When I first got to Rekart's Doctor Who in the early 1990s, I was unprepared to walk into a space where Remembrance of the Daleks was considered the greatest Doctor Who story of all time. I had seen it once and I considered it forgettable and disposable. I have come to appreciate that story over the years, thanks to the tutelage that I got on Rekart's. Remembrance of the Daleks is on my top 60 list, where Black Orchid, I believe, is not.
Mm.
That being said, one of the selling points for Remembrance of the Daleks is that it's a story where the Doctor stays behind to attend the funeral of a character who dies during the making of the story. That was the character played by Dursley McLinden, and that is a character that was expressly paid homage to by Russell T. Davies in It's a Sin.
Yeah.
However, the Doctor going to Mike's funeral in Remembrance is not the first time that the Doctor goes to somebody's funeral. That, in fact, happens right here at the end of Black Orchid. So one of the things that is viewed as a high selling point for Remembrance actually happens here first, in a story that is not quite as beloved.
Yes, wow. That's a really good point. I hadn't thought of that parallel before, but you're right. I mean, I don't know if it's a strictly necessary coda to the end of the story. I think it sort of, again, provides that sort of humanity to the Doctor as it's sort of compared against maybe the sort of dark undercurrent of what the aristocracy is actually like, and particularly Lady Cranley, who is a fascinating character in this book. Like, do you mind if we segue into her for a bit? Because I just think she's wonderfully written here.
Absolutely, by all means.
I mean, I can't say this any other way. Basically, she's a MILF, right? You've got Terence Dudley, who is so in love with this creation. And it's sort of, you know, characterized as she's a bewitching lady who casts spells on the weather from the great balcony at Cranley Hall. And if I hadn't seen this episode, you know, prior to reading the novelization, I'd immediately conjure Elizabeth Hurley or Kate Beckinsale in this role, you know, sort of, you know, that very elegant Dowager Martinez who, you know, whose beauty belies her age, I think he sort of mentions. But of course, that's the veneer and, you know, her civility and her sort of great beauty and, you know, gregarious nature, I guess, is just the mask under which there's someone who's, I guess, ultimately damaged. You know, she you sort of get, it's perhaps not entirely sort of expounded on in the story, but in the novelization, but this is a mother who has lost her son in many regards, and the fallout of that and this sort of emotional turmoil and damage that that causes to a mother, but also to the extended family over which I guess she's the matriarch. It's just it's a really sort of lovely sort of psychological aspect to the story that maybe isn't all that there in the television series up until perhaps that moment where Madge gets that line about, you know, the filthy jungle and the way that she spits it out, and you sort of start hinted at that point. But instead here it's sort of interwoven throughout, and occasionally the mask will slip. There's a moment where Anne and Nyssa are in the identical dress, and they're dancing to a particular song. And gosh, I wish I could find the quote. I've written it down here somewhere. But effectively, you know, she wants, this is Lady Cranley, she wants the music to stop and to scream, but she could never bring herself to do that because of her social position. So that the sort of repressed nature of her sort of role, I guess, as well, is sort of hinted at there. And all of this just sort of adds up, I guess, into that sort of final discussion that Anne and Lady Cranley have about the true nature of, you know, the creature, as it's called, who's actually George Cranley. Well, George Beauchamp, as they're renamed here, and it's the ninth Duke of Cranley. And that's superb. Again, this is what you can do in 140-odd pages for a two-parter that's fleshed out, where you can start to really go into the motivations, the interiority, the emotional sort of history, I guess, and estate of these characters as well. I just think it's particularly well done here.
So these are all terrific points. What I want to move on to now, however, is the games portion of the hour. And I am looking at the second Doctor Who quiz book, which I purchased at Dragon Castle Books in Las Vegas last month. And we're looking at the first quiz for Adventures in History, page 13.
Oh, nice.
I'm going to read you five questions, the first five questions from this 20-question quiz. And 3 out of 5 is winning. I expect nothing less than 5 out of 5 from you.
Oh, no.
But first, I need to move Smudge out of the way because she has taken up residence on the keyboard and I can't see her right now.
Hello, Smudge.
Cannot have a podcast without Smudge making herself known on the recording.
Adorable.
So, question number one. What brought about the creation of the universe?
Well, it depends who you ask, but if we're talking about Terminus, it's the sort of, I don't like the idea, but the explosion of that sort of fuel cells of that space station. Then you've got the explanation that the Doctor gives in Edge of Destruction at the end of that two-parter, which is just basically an exercise in explaining the Big Bang Theory. And I guess the other one is Castrovalva, where you sort of get the hydrogen. Well, it would be outrush, but it's an inrush when approaching it backwards. So it's one of those three. Am I allowed to say that, or do I need to pick one?
Nigel Robinson has a definitive answer in mind, so give me the answer okay. That Nigel Robinson would have given us on page 71 of the second Doctor Who quiz book.
I'm going to go with the Terminus explanation.
You are correct. The ejection okay. into the void of one of Terminus's fuel tanks, which then exploded, causing the biggest bang in history, Event 1. Although that dips into Legopolis as Smudge! Darn it, I just tried to get me.
She doesn't like Terminus either.
No, she does not like Terminus or this book. Question two, what brought about life on Earth?
This is Scaroth spaceship exploding.
Correct. The explosion of the Jaggeroth spacecraft some 400 million years ago, the radiation from which sparked off a chemical reaction in the amino acids on the planet. Question three, according to Susan, and this may be relevant for the new series where Susan got a prominent mention last week in The Devil's Court. According to Susan, what is the Doctor's favorite period of Earth history?
The French Revolution.
Exactly. Question four. Name the four survivors of the ship which foundered on Fang Rock during the Rutan's attack on that islet.
Oh, gosh. Skinsale, Palmerdale, Adelaide, and the boatswain, who is...
You've crushed it. I'll give you a hint as to the... They call him the coxswain in the answer.
Coxswain,
key.
That's it. Yeah.
Horror of Fang Rock was supposed to be State of Decay. The BBC said, no, we are doing a prestige production of Dracula. You can't do a vampire story. Terrence instead turns State of Decay into a vampire story called Horror of Fang Rock, and the fourth character is named directly for one of the key characters in Dracula.
Oh, is it Harker?
Yes, it is Harker.
Okay, thank you for the prompt.
That is Terence being very, very, very clever. Question five, and you've already won, but this is for the perfect score. What Chinese magician played at the Palace Theater in the late 19th century?
The great Li Xian Chang.
Exactly. 5 out of 5, my friend. Well done.
The pressure is off. Okay, great. I can relax. I love also the way that Nigel Robinson frames those answers. And again, I think we were talking off camera about this, or pre-recording about this. One of my sort of great ins into Doctor Who about a year into my fandom was finding the first of those quiz books. And just the beautiful sort of like one, two sentence answers that Nigel Robinson gives were so evocative of the story that you were allowed to fill in the blanks, often erroneously. But it was a great window, I guess, into the landscape of Doctor Who from an unearthly child through to the end of Legopolis. So, yeah, huge, huge place in my heart for the Nigel Robinson, particularly the first one, the quiz books.
And some of those answers are deep cuts that requires a graduate level degree of knowledge of the show. I mean, you're talking about a book that was published in 1983. So Horror of Fang Rock is already 5 years behind us. It's never been screened more than once, unless there was a rerun that I'm forgetting. There was a novelization. I wonder how many kids who bought this book off the shelf in 1983 or in America in the following years were able to name all 4 minor characters from Horror of Fang Rock.
Well, I couldn't without your prompting, and I think I saw Horror of Fang Rock about 6 months ago, so...
All right, let's go a step further. Name the 4 actors who play those 4 characters.
No, I'm sorry, I can't do that. Alan... I forget his last name.
Alan Rowe.
Alan Rowe, that's right.
Now,
he's
Alan Rowe was the partner, I believe... I want to get this right. I believe he was the partner of Jeffrey Belden.
Yes.
So I can imagine the two of them at home. I was offered a role on Doctor Who, and I'm going to play it with pained dignity. And then Jeffrey goes, I was offered a role on Doctor Who. I want to play it very differently. So, yes, Alan Rowe, of the 4, he was the one who had the most appearances on Doctor Who. So that was the easy one.
And that's why he sticks out. And to be fair, they've fallen out of my mind at 9 o'clock on a Saturday morning. So I'm sorry. I'm going to have to fail myself here.
Sean Caffrey would have played the Colonel Palmerdale.
Okay.
Oh, sorry. Alan Rowe was the Colonel. He was Sean Caffrey was Lord Palmerdale. Palmerdale, Skinsale, almost rhyming names.
Hmm.
The only reason that I know the actor who played Harker is because... Obviously, Harker was also a character in the Francis Ford Coppola version of Dracula, which came out in the early 1990s, played by Keanu Reeves. For years in my head, anytime I thought about the Francis Ford Coppola version of Dracula, I had in my mind this image of reading in the TV guide the cast list for Bram Stoker's Dracula with Harker played by Rio Fanning. Like, why do I have the name Rio Fanning stuck in my head when Harker was clearly played by Keanu Reeves? Turns out I was misremembering this story where Harker was played by Rio Fanning in Horror of Fang Rock. Which is a long-winded way of saying I have no recollection at all of who played Adelaide, so I have to go to Wikipedia for that.
Okay. Isn't it funny how the fan brain works?
It is very funny how the fan brain works, or in this case, doesn't work. So Adelaide was played by Annette Woollett, who does not have her own Wikipedia page. Rio Fanning does, Sean Caffrey does, Alan Rose certainly does, but Annette Woollett is unknown to Wikipedia.
Hmm. There you go.
So that's so we didn't do quite as well on the cast list as we did on the quiz book. Well, we've come to the end of the hour, Stephen. It is always a delight and a pleasure and a blast having you on. Any more notes about Black Orchid that you want to mention that I was talking too much and didn't give you a chance to get into?
No. I spoke a lot there, and to be perfectly honest, I've got so many pages of notes, and I'm not sure all of them are particularly necessarily or relevant. I think the tropes, I just want to sort of checklist because it's just sort of bugging me to sort of get through this. But the tropes here are just so heavy. And I guess it's part of the architecture of Dudley's sort of storytelling. And if you're not familiar with them, I think actually we are all familiar with them, but it sort of needs to be pointed out sometimes. I think there's an element of the Elephant Man trope there in terms of the deformed figure in the attic, which sort of sort of speaks to that sort of Simpsons episode, Treehouse of Horrors, evil twin in the attic, Hugo.
Hugo,
being,
that's right.
Yeah. But which itself has sort of literary antecedents in terms of Jane Eyre, the Bertha character, and Phantom of the Opera. Doctor Who, you know, has done it, and will do it later on as well in terms of Ghostlight, The Idiot's Land, and Crimson Horror. But, you know, it sort of goes all the way back to, actually, I would say, the myth of the Minotaur, where, you know, the sort of the bastard son of Pasiphae, in the full form of Zeus being the coming down to her as the bull, is that sort of deformed figure that's kept in the maze built by Daedalus under the palace of Knossos. So, you know, this has like really strong and, you know, often cited tropes in terms of that aspect as well. But also the identical stranger, which it's always struck me as a bit strange why it wasn't Tegan. Like, it couldn't have been like Tegan's great aunt or something like that, or great great aunt. Instead, you've got sort of, you know, Nyssa of Traken from the other side of the universe having, you know, the exact same identical gene pool as Anne Talbot, which is just a bit strange. But again, you know, this is something that Doctor Who goes back to with and has done before with the Massacre and Enemy of the World, and even Androids of Tara to some degree as well, the sort of the doppelganger of Romana and the Princess.
I got to give a shout out here to Justin Richards, who did The Missing Adventure mm-hmm. in the mid-1990s, The Sands of Time. It is a sequel to Pyramids
yes.
of Mars, but it brings back Anne Talbot, and I won't say how because that would be a spoiler.
Yeah, absolutely. And I had this later on in my notes and I forgot entirely about it. Thank you for bringing this up. If anyone hasn't read Justin Richards' Sands of Time, please do go and read it. It's wonderful and a great sort of evocation of the period. And that Davison period, I guess, that is so tonally different. You know, we talked about this before. You mentioned it, how season 19 sort of goes from different genre to different genre. I think that's one of the things that sort of marks the Davison era as a whole. And maybe in hindsight is a bit of its strength, you know, through that diversity, but certainly doesn't seem to be planned. And, you know, season 19 largely doesn't have a script editor for a lot of it, I guess. But that sort of weird tonality, that sort of spectrum between frock and gun is how it sort of continually vacillates between the two of them. And I just think it's one of those sort of great, interesting, maybe accidental, you know, designs of the Davison era of Doctor Who.
The Sands of Time comes out in May 1996. As you are watching the TV movie, you possibly would have had this book in your hand. But 1996 was the year of the sequel for The Missing Adventures. So The Sands of Time is a sequel to Pyramids of Mars. The next book is Killing Ground, which is a sequel to a different Steve Lyons Missing Adventure, Time of Your Life, and is also a side of the story. July 1996, The Scales of Injustice by friend of the show Gary Russell, who's been on this show twice as an interview guest. He does a sequel to The Silurians, and also it is the final story of Season 7 and a departure for Liz Shaw. August 1996 by David A. McKinty, The Shadow of Wang Chiang, which is a sequel to Talons, which we mentioned earlier on this show. And then in September, you have Twilight of the Gods by Christopher Bullis, which ends up being a sequel to The Web Planet. So that's five sequel novels in a row. I would argue, and different people will feel differently, and apologies to Gary, who's now a friend, I think Sands of Time is the best of those five books.
I love The Scales of Injustice, but Sands of Time is sitting at the top of that list, I would say, too.
I need to do a Missing Adventures reread. The last four books, I was already broke at that point, so I've only read one of the four, and that was The Dark Path. I only read one of the four as it came out. I then read A Device of Death as a PDF a couple of years ago during my TV pilgrimage. I've never finished The Well-Mannered War, and I've never read anything about Burning Heart. So maybe I should go back and finish my Missing Adventures, but those are some underrated books, some underrated novels there.
Yeah, I think just in terms of the world mattered more, perhaps don't read it until after you've watched a few Avengers episodes. It might sort of feel a bit more familiar in that regard afterwards. But Empire of Glass, which I've spoken about on Cy Hart's Library of Impossible Things podcast, is probably the best missing adventure in my book, I would say.
I totally agree. I did, when I was doing my blog version of The Pilgrimage in 2013, which ends with the Faceless Ones because it was too much work for me, I did a blog post on Empire of Glass. It is hilarious because it is the ultimate Doctor Who trope. The first Doctor is mistaken for a historical figure, a regressive conservative cardinal, who, if you look at his actual person, if you look at his painting, he looks nothing like William Hartnell. But for the purpose of the book, he is said to be the Doctor's exact double. You have Stephen Taylor getting a great story arc. You have a lot of historical figures. You tie in the mystery of Roanoke. You tie in Shakespeare, Christopher Marlowe. It is just a wonderful, and it's a pseudo-historical, and it's fitting that it sort of kind of takes place after the Time Meddler, which is the great-granddaddy of pseudo-historicals. But yeah, I cannot praise Empire of Glass enough. And yeah, I definitely enjoyed your appearance on the library show, and I will put a link to that in the show notes.
That's very kind of you, thank you. But yes, the other thing that I should mention about Empire of Glass, heavily influenced, I would say, by Italo Calvino's Invisible Cities, which I believe is the most beautiful book written after the Second World War, but also Jeanette Winterson's The Passion, which is set in Venice as well. And if anyone's read either of those two, they'll sort of see the allusions and the references in Empire of Glass as well. So it's a beautifully written book and inspired by beautiful literature as well.
All right, well, Stephen, I want to thank you very, very much. We've talked about your other podcast.
My pleasure.
Episode with Cy. We've talked about your Avengers podcast. We've talked about your blog. I will have links to all those things in the show notes.
Oh, thank you. It's very kind of you. And thank you for having me on. It's been an absolute joy to talk about a target novelization that I think is rather overlooked and perhaps unfairly, in the sense that, yes, it's not the doomsday weapon, as I say, but there's a lot of merit to it.
And having shattered the streak of only having you on every 41 episodes, I can confirm that your next appearance is for a Hartnell historical, and it's coming up in much less than 41 books from now.
I look forward to it. Thank you.
Black Orchid by Terence Dudley. Televised as Black Orchid by Terence Dudley. Televised in March 1982. Paperback release date February 19th, 1987. Target book number 113. Cover artist Tony Masero. On a lazy June afternoon in 1925, the TARDIS materializes at the tiny railway station of Cranley Halt. Warmly welcomed by the local gentry, the time travelers look forward to a well-deserved rest from their adventures. After a stunning performance at a friendly cricket match, the Doctor, together with Tegan, Adric, and Nyssa, is invited to a splendid masked ball by Lady Cranley and her son, Charles. But a dark menace haunts the secret corridors of Cranley Hall, and before the ball is over, the quiet summer will be shattered by the shocking discovery of a brutal murder. The three Peter Davison two-part stories present an interesting dilemma for the novelizations line. Target, by the mid-1980s, typically allotted between 128 and 144 pages per book, a good 20 pages or so longer per book than where Terence Dix found himself in the late 1970s. But that assumed most books were adapted from 4 or 6-part TV stories. The two-parters are lucky beneficiaries of this standard page count. Target was not going to publish a 64-page book for a two-part story. That's not economically feasible. So the adapter would have literally twice as much space to work with. Target tends to handle this conundrum in different ways, which Stephen and I went through earlier. For The Awakening, the first of the two-parters to see print, Eric Pringle released a faithful scene-by-scene and line-by-line retelling of the TV script, but with added descriptions and character insights to fill out the extra 64 pages. For The King's Demons, Terence Dudley turned in a rather different story to his original scripts, with many added scenes, and with a near completely different ending. Black Orchid, also by Dudley, is not only the last of the Davison two-parters to see print, but is also the last Peter Davison novelization, full stop. Even though it was the first of the Davison two-parters on TV, Dudley himself appears confused by this reversal of fortune. He has the Doctor remember the events of The King's Demons, which is going to confuse any target reader who approaches the novelizations in story order rather than publication order. At first, Dudley appears to be doing what Pringle did, rather than what he himself did in The King's Demons book. In the opening chapters, there are several added or prolonged scenes, but the dialogue is typically quite faithful to what ended up on television, with the omission of continuity dialogue added by script editor Eric Sayward, referencing back to the previous televised story, Sayward's own The Visitation, which was the first Peter Davison novelization, by the way. While the extra material is interesting, the book starts off with a somewhat inconsequential feel. The original cover is striking, with the faithfully depicted clown juggling an extraordinary amount of balls. That's what she said. But then you have the prose. Dudley falls into the unfortunate habit of adding at least one adjective for every single noun, in every single sentence, in every single paragraph. This does help fill out the page count, but it would have been, I imagine, a dreadful chore for the audiobook narrator, Michael Cochran, who played Lord Cranley on TV, and then came back to play Redvers Fen Cooper in Ghostlight at the end of the decade. Surprisingly, Keegan fares quite well in print this time, as you heard me discuss earlier with Stephen. I was wary going in, due to the unfair and stereotyped way that Dudley wrote her previously in King's Demons, but here all the added cricket descriptions and rules and lore are filtered through her POV, which gives her a chance to show off her love for the game. There is also, among all the comedy of manners, as Stephen called it, a moment where Tegan reflects that the serving girls of 1925 are not dissimilar to her own occupation of air hostess in 1981. And it's Tegan in the book who insists that the Doctor's companions be arrested as accessories alongside him in the Part 2 material, an agency denied her on TV. Dudley also plays well with the period setting. As in his other book, with the medieval castle, here the mansion of Cranley Hall, and we learn the family's proper name is Beauchamp, or Beecham, a detail presumably snipped out by Sayward on TV. Anyway, Cranley Hall is a proper character in the book.
Splendid! Mother, may I introduce Tegan and Adric?
How do you do? What enchanting names.
And this is Nyssa.
How extraordinary.
Yes, isn't it?
Worcestershire.
Apparently not.
Nyssa, did you say?
Yes.
Forgive me, my dear, but you must be a Worcestershire Talbot.
No, I'm not.
Are you quite sure?
Quite sure.
Robert?
Uncanny. Quite uncanny.
Two peas in a pod. Positively two peas in a pod.
Beg your pardon?
Forgive a pardonable curiosity, my dear, but where are you from?
The Empire of Trachan.
Really?
There's lots more hide-and-seek with George Cranley, and a creepy added moment at the end of Chapter 2 as he stalks Anne through a room full of armor. The Doctor's exploration of the attic and hidden apartment late in Part 1 is given added space, with some extra terror and some extra hide-and-seek. This is either material cut from the draft script by Sayward for timing, or invented for the book, but it keeps the pages turning and does not serve as mere padding. As the story is an Agatha Christie lift, there is unfortunately a racist stereotype walking around, but Dudley does portray Latoni a little more fairly in the book, with Lady Cranley treating him as a visiting dignitary, he's said to be the chief of his tribe, rather than as just another servant who dies of stupidity, as happens with the character on TV. Once you get past the profuse proliferation of additive adjectives, the prose has its moments. Dudley writes with a vocabulary befitting the period setting, and belying the fact that this is nominally a children's book, Quote, he'd had no right to penetrate the secret passages of Cranley Hall, but his Protean curiosity demanded satisfaction about the nature of any fugitives seeking sanctuary here. Again, that's too many adjectives, but it's great vocabulary for the 12-year-old reader. Of course, at other times he overdoes it, then carries alliteration a bit too far, to quote The Invasion of Time. Quote, a danger, a deadliness in the deliberate descent. And who could forget? The doctor looked back penitently at the perspiring policeman. Huh. The added words and dialogue allows us to see the characters in slightly different lights. The doctor shows more curiosity as to the identity of the dead man in the cupboard. Lady Cranley gives a more detailed history of her home, and Nyssa needs constant explanations of the 1920s idioms, such as the costumes at the ball and the abundance of bird metaphors. And Dudley shows a keen understanding of the landed aristocracy decades before Downton Abbey or Bridgerton. Quote, Sir Robert frowned. He was deeply worried that such an exemplary cricketer appeared not to have an exemplary character to match. It denied a whole code of ethics, contradicted a whole way of life. Dudley has a good handle on the doctor's thought processes, too. Quote, the doctor had gambled on the maxim that fortune favors the brave, and hoped that it extended to the foolhardy. That's a great mission statement for our favorite Time Lord. At the end, though, Dudley again pulls a King's Demons, and changes up the ending. Not quite as drastically as King's Demons, but he does change it. The part 2 material is slightly restructured, with the Doctor now being the one to discover the second body, James the Footman, and presenting a more vigorous defense of his own innocence. There's even a Doctor Who joke, and name checks to George Washington and Winston Churchill. As he did in The King's Demons, Dudley saves a character who died on TV, and in fact, the character who survives is rescued by the very person who on TV had killed him. So if you can get past the excess verbiage and the occasional run-on sentence, Black Orchid pretty much sings in print. Dudley uses the extra space well to get into his characters' heads, to explain the period setting, and give more backstory to Cranley Hall, and to tell a slightly different story from the familiar TV one. Black Orchid has, I feel, an unfair reputation on TV, but the book is a lively pastiche of many period British writers, and in the end, I feel this is a successful book.
What is it?
Harry, I'm standing on a landmine. I felt it shift. If I move my foot, it might detonate it.
Don't move your foot.
I won't.
So now, let's talk about Boom, last night's new episode. Or why I both love and hate the Moffat era. After two strikingly different episodes doing things Doctor Who hasn't done before, we get an uber-trad Moff script that could have been written and aired in 2006 without any changes. The first 30 minutes are glorious. A stage play, riffing on Genesis of the Daleks Part 1, the audio clip that I played a minute ago. These moments strip down the Doctor's personality, because he runs into a battlefield to help someone that he heard screaming, but gets stuck in a situation he cannot control, where his chatter is called out as babbling, where people don't follow his instructions, because nobody, not even Ruby, knows him well enough to know that what he's saying is very good advice. The whole planet is in danger, and the limited cast members could die in a flash. The ambulance is a fine villain, and the political anger is exactly what I'm here for. Did you see the words thoughts and prayers flashing on the ambulance every few minutes? In America, that is the right wing's mocking non-response to the American school shooting epidemic. It's perfectly placed. I'm also getting better at spotting Susan Twist's cameos, a different one every shooty episode so far, which is good considering that a week ago at this time I'd never heard of her. And that was Virata Sethu in a major role in this episode, and we'll be seeing a lot more of her in the second season, though I am not delving deep enough into spoilers to know if she'll be playing the same character. I am getting tired of Moffat's space Anglican Marines, though. But this is the 7th episode in a row written by a 60-year-old white guy, and please, can we not do that anymore? The explanation of the Sky Boat song, after 10 years of Outlander, sounds like it was written years ago and not updated for a more in-the-know audience. Outlander's been on the air for about 10 years, and to be unfairly reductive, it is off-licensed Doctor Who fanfiction. We all know the Sky Boat song by now. Moff leavens the mavity of the landmine situation with his own brand of cringe humor that again feels like 2006's idea of edgy, and nothing we need explained to us in 2024. The word tattoo appears like 20 times, the ideal number should be zero, and my kid was not sure where lesbian Gymkhana was going. In his Nerdist interview for this story, and that is a very good interview, Moff riffs on the Doctor's quote-unquote hypocrisy about war and about faith. Honestly, those are not Doctor traits that I want to hear about. That conception doesn't fit Shudi's Doctor. It's too early in his run for that kind of cynicism and misanthropy, and Moff's personal hang-ups about his own vision of the Doctor, again, feel very 2014, if not 2005. I wanted to love Boom, and for the first 30 minutes, I did. But the ending, with its piety and emotion, if not mawkishness, felt forced and out of place. In short, Boom is the most Moffat script that ever Moffed. Doctor Who shines best when it's young writers telling new stories. I mentioned this earlier in the program. This is a new streaming era of Doctor Who, with the show's biggest audience ever. But the same old people are still in charge. And what should have been a boom ends a little bit with a whimper.
It's rocking.
Wedge something under it. Make it firm.
Yes, I'm trying to, Sarah. Back up, Sarah.
You back up too, honey. No point in risking both our lives.
No, Doctor, you'll have a better chance if I hold it firm.
Please, Harry, don't be difficult.
Don't you argue, Doctor.
Next time on Doctor Who Literature, we are going back into the past once again, and we're going back into the Hartnell era, and forgive this rapidly aging man for finding himself at home in the Hartnell era. It is going to be another Target novelization by a first-time Target writer, and it's going to take liberties with the underlying script. Joining me is a good friend of the program, Leland Stolt, from the Indoctrination Podcast, which is also in Season 3 of William Hartnell. So unlike Parts 3 and 4 of the Ark, we are not going to have to wait 700 years for his opinion. Thank you for joining me on another episode of Doctor Who Literature. The executive producer is David Barsky. The podcast is produced by Jim Sangster and yours truly. This week's episode was written and edited by me. Our logo was designed by Jim Sangster. Special thanks to my special guest, Stephen B. from New to Who. This podcast can be found on most of your podcast apps of choice. You can find all past episodes at podcasters.spotify.com/pod/show/Doctor Who Lit. It really helps if you rate 5 stars and subscribe. You can find me on Blue Sky and YouTube at Doctor Who Novels, that's Dr. Who Novels, and on email at Doctor Who Literature, that's drwholiterature@gmail.com. Please drop me a line with your comments, questions, and suggestions. Thank you for listening, and whatever you do, keep turning the pages.
Doctor Who Podcast Network.